Measuring very low power beams of light can be tricky. At low powers, even small values of noise, drift, or offset can have major impact on your readings. In this video, we'll look at some best practices that can help you get the best performance from your very low power measurements. As background, we'll briefly mention what sort of sensors we use and what issues set the lower limits on power levels we can measure. Then the best practices and tips will have some context for you. Sensors. Measurements of this sort usually make use of a photodiode-based sensor, suitably calibrated and stabilized, with various semiconductor materials used for various spectral regions. A photodiode is fast and sensitive. However, its spectral response is narrow and not at all flat. Also, there is some sensitivity to incidence angle and to temperature. If power levels are a bit higher, thermal sensors can sometimes be used instead. Based on a different physical mechanism than semiconductor detectors, thermal detectors can have absorbers with broadband and flat spectral response and little or no angle effect. On the other hand, even the most sensitive thermal sensors can measure down only as low as a few microwatts at best. While usually not affected much by ambient temperature within a specified range, they can be very sensitive to even slight changes in temperature with time. What limits the low end of measurable power? The lowest power that a given sensor can measure is limited most fundamentally by noise. For thermal sensors, there's also, for some sensor configurations, an issue of drift, which is essentially a slow noise. At Ophir, we typically specify a power sensor's minimum measurable power as 10 to 20 times the noise plus drift where relevant. Though the sensors will respond to powers lower than that, clearly the closer one gets to the noise level, the lower the signal-to-noise ratio becomes, and the noisier and less meaningful the reading will be. Besides random noise, there is also a fixed offset to deal with. Offset can show up in several ways. Optical offset results from unwanted ambient light or heat entering the sensor and being measured along with the target beam. The little bit of light coming in through a crack under the door in a darkened lab could be an example of this if we're trying to measure power that's low enough for this to matter. Electrical offset can build up in the instrument electronics over time. When using thermal sensors, a source of unwanted heat near the sensor could introduce a thermal offset. For example, the heat emitted by an LED could be detected by the sensor and be added to the reading. Photodiode-based sensors exhibit a temperature coefficient of sensitivity. This is another type of offset in the reading, which is a function of the semiconductor and the wavelength of the light being measured. And now we can talk about things you can do to maximize your accuracy. These are some black belt tips for getting top performance in a challenging type of measurement. We'll summarize these at the end. For dealing with noise, the meter's average function displays the running average of the power reading over a selected time period instead of the actual real-time power reading. This can help smooth out the jumpiness in the readings of an unstable beam by averaging out random noise. Measuring below the noise floor is sometimes made possible by using a lock-in amplifier. The beam is modulated at a specific frequency by a chopper, and the lock-in amplifier essentially ignores any signal that's not modulated at the specific frequency. Noise can be reduced with this technique by several orders of magnitude. Ophir has a family of sensors called the RM9 family that uses this method to measure powers as low as the femtowatt range. For dealing with offset, zeroing the instrument removes electrical offset that builds up over time. We recommend doing this periodically, say every month or so. Optical offset, unwanted background light or heat, can be removed using the meter's offset function. It's important to keep external disturbances to a minimum. Turn off or block the beam without affecting anything else. Then check if the reading is in fact zero. If there's any offset now, use the offset function to automatically subtract this value from subsequent measurements. For photodiode sensors, check that your measurement conditions won't cause temperature effects. Graphs of the relevant temperature sensitivity coefficients are found in our catalog and on our website. If you're measuring power of a pulsed beam with a photodiode sensor, there are two issues to consider. One, the maximum pulse energy is listed in the sensor's spec sheet. This is important even though we're not actually measuring energy, since too high pulse energy can cause momentary saturation of the detector, which can lead to inaccurate measurements. Two, for measuring average power of pulsed beams having pulse rates less than about 100 Hz, we generally don't recommend using photodiode sensors if possible. This is because of a number of effects that can happen related to the fast physical response time of photodiode sensors. These are discussed in detail in a number of tutorials and videos on our website. For thermal sensors, check that the environment is thermally stable. A temperature change of even 1 degree Celsius per minute can be picked up by a thermal sensor, it's that sensitive, and cause heat flow that would be misinterpreted by the sensor as incoming laser power. Check that there's no nearby heat source causing any thermal offset. That might even be the light source itself. Zero the sensor offset only when the sensor's in thermal equilibrium with its environment. Otherwise, you might be zeroing out an offset that will soon change, and continuing to subtract its value from the readings would then introduce an error. Be sure the sensor's clean. Trivial, perhaps, but worth checking just in case. Confirm the alignment of your setup. The accuracy of measurements may be affected by things like angles between the beam and the sensor, centering of the beam and the sensor's aperture, the fraction of the sensor's aperture that's being used. Making sure these are fixed and stable, perhaps using a mechanical jig if necessary, could eliminate unwanted variability and contribute to the repeatability of your measurements. Quick summary: averaging, lock-in amplifier, zeroing the meter, offset subtraction. Check the temperature, pulses, stable thermal environment, sensor cleanliness, and optical alignment. Contact us to see how we can help you with your application directly through our local representatives or via our website.